Well, thank you, Pastor John Fry, for starting our service this morning. Good morning, everybody. Welcome to Calvary. My name is Brandon. I'm on staff here at the church working with our young adults, as well as with our worship ministry here. And this morning, I have the privilege of leading us into worship and praise. So let's rise to our feet as we just jump right into worship and sing Hosanna, Praise is Rising.
Praise is rising, and eyes are turning to you. We turn to you, and hope is stirring, hearts are yearning for you. We long for you,
because when we see him, we find the strength.
When we see you, we find strength to face the day. And in your presence, all our fears are washed away. They're washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna. You are the God who saves us, worthy of all.
Broken lives are made new.
And in your kingdom, broken lives are made new. You make us new. It's when we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears.
Washed away,
washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna. You are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna. Come have your way.
Strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away.
It's when we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away. They're washed away.
Love endures forever.
For he is good, he is above all things. His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise.
With a mighty hand, with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm.
His love endures forever. For the life that's been reborn, his love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise. So we sing praise, we sing praise, we sing praise. Forever God is faithful, forever God is strong, forever God is with us, forever.
From the rising to the setting sun.
From the rising to the setting sun. His love endures forever.
By the grace of God, we will carry on.
His love endures forever. Sing praise. Sing praise. Sing praise. God is with us forever.
Oh, he is faithful, he's faithful.
Forever God is faithful. Forever God is strong. Forever God is with us forever. Oh, forever.
Take this time, let's just set our hearts and our minds on the cornerstone, on Christ. Let's just sing the words of this old hymn, my hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and his righteousness. Christ. Verse again, my hope is built.
My hope is built on nothing less, ooh, than Jesus' blood and righteousness. God, I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong, in
Good morning, everyone. My name is Mark Canada, and I'm the pastor of student ministries here at Calvary Church. And if this is your first time with us at Calvary, we just want to extend a warm welcome to you. Thank you so much for being here with us this morning. And if you are a guest with us, I'd invite you to look in the pew right in front of you, and we have our Calvary guest connection cards. And I would ask that if you could please fill this out for us and place it in the offering basket when it comes by, or take it with you to our welcome gathering after the service. Our welcome gathering takes place right next to the chapel in our new welcome gathering room. And if you're here and interested of learning more about Calvary Church, of what Calvary Church is all about, or just how to get involved here at Calvary Church, I would encourage you to join us at the welcome gathering immediately following this service. It will take no more than 10 minutes, and it's a great way for you to find out how to get more connected here at Calvary Church. Next, I'd invite you to actually open up your bulletins, and inside your bulletin is this nice-looking card, and it says launch, and it has a rocket on it. And you may be wondering, what in the world is this? Now, for those of you who were here last year for our launch event, you know that launch is an incredibly exciting time where we get motivated, inspired, and ready for what God's going to be doing this next year. And so launch is happening again this year, Wednesday, August 27th from 6:30 to 8:30. We want you to put it on your calendars. Take this with you as a reminder to come and join us that Wednesday evening so that you will know and be inspired and motivated for what God has in store for this next year, and you can know how to best be involved. So please put that on your calendars. Now, if you would, join with me as we pray and ask the Lord to open our eyes, open our hearts and our minds for what he has in store for us this morning. Let's pray. Father, we just want to stop right now and we want to thank you for the opportunity to gather together as the body of Christ. Thank you so much that we're able to be here, to open up your word, to sing songs and praises to you, Lord. And I pray this morning that you would help us to be humble and teachable. Father, that you would open our minds, that you would open our hearts to see you clearly, to see your word clearly, to know you in ways that we've never known you before. And as we sing and continue to sing songs, Father, I pray that the words that are coming from our mouths would be true of what's going on in our hearts. And so, God, we come before you as a people asking you to do whatever you want to do this morning, that we're yours. Lord, I think of our global partners who are located all around the world. And Father, I ask this morning that you would be their rock, that you would be their comfort, that you would be using them to extend the gospel in the spheres of influence in which you've placed them. And that the same would be true for us here this morning at Calvary Church, God, that you would continue to use us here in Lancaster County to spread your good news, your gospel, so that people can go from death to life. Lord, I think of the people that aren't able to be with us here this morning that are a part of the body. And God, I pray that you would continue to open their minds and their hearts, God, whether it's through the radio or over the internet, whether they're listening or not able to listen this morning. God, could you continue to unite the body here at Calvary Church for your namesake and for your glory? So God, we commit this morning to you. May you be glorified. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Sees the earth shaken and stirred, can be calmed and broken from my regard. And through it all, my eyes are open. Through it all, it is well. Through it all. is well. Oh, yes, it is. Through it all, through it all, my eyes are on you, and it is well with me.
Reading from the book of 1 Peter, chapter 1. Having purified your souls by your obedience to the truth for sincere brotherly love, love one another earnestly from a pure heart. Since you have been born again, not of perishable seed, but of the imperishable, through the living and abiding word of God. For it is written, all flesh is like grass, and all its glory like the flower of grass. The grass withers and the flower falls, but the word of the Lord remains forever. And this word is the good news that was preached to you. So put away all malice, put away all deceit, put away all hypocrisy, put away all envy and all slander. Like newborn infants, long for the pure spiritual milk, that by it you may grow up into salvation. If indeed you have tasted that the Lord is good. Let's stand together as we just sing in response to the word. I'm going to sing these words. Higher than the mountains that I face, stronger than the power of the grave, the one thing that remains is the love of the Father.
Your love never fails, never gives up, never runs out on me. Oh, it's your love.
Good morning. My name's Steve Kilgore. I'm one of the pastors here at Calvary Church, and I'm privileged to continue our series in 1 Peter, Under Pressure, Handling Pressure God's Way. Have you ever noticed how different people respond to pressure? Some people just buckle down and grind it out. Other people have trouble getting off the couch. Other people get a little glassy-eyed. Some people just get angry and they go after it, and some people cry. Some people move really quickly when they're under pressure and you see them. Other people just start moving really slow. Some become warriors. Some become worriers. No matter how you instinctively respond to pressure, the book of 1 Peter calls us to a new perspective. To develop a new perspective on the pressure that you will face. A perspective that is God-centered, Christ-focused, and hope-inspiring. Let me try to illustrate it this way. Over the last few, a week ago, we had the opportunity to spend some time on the beach. And I need you to do me a favor. I need you to hold up your arm and stick your thumb up. Everybody, this is an all skate. Now, look at your thumb. I'm going to tell Bo that you all gave me a thumbs up, by the way. If you can try to focus on the picture and your thumb at the same time. Can you focus on both at the same time? No, we can really only focus on one thing. We can only have clear perspective on one thing at a time. And that's what Peter has been talking to us about. That in the middle of pressure, how can we have the right perspective? How can we look at the right thing, not be sidetracked by the pressure, but how can we grow through the pressure? And so that's what he's going to be challenging us to have the right perspective. Peter never diminishes the pain that we're going through. He never says that what we're going through is insignificant. He simply says, this is how I want you to handle it. In the midst of trouble, difficulty, and pressure, he gives us instruction for how to handle it God's way. That's the challenge of the book. How do we have a right perspective on the difficulties that we have? And just to give you a preview of the end of the book, look at 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 10. And after you have suffered a little while, the reality of suffering, the God of all grace, who has called us to his eternal glory in Christ, will himself restore, comfort, strengthen, and establish you. What an awesome promise. In spite of, or in the presence of the difficulty that you go through, this is what God will do for you. Correct your perspective. Keep looking at him. Over the next several weeks, we will have the opportunity to learn from Peter about certain circumstances and certain people that will cause difficulty, put us under pressure. But the reality is that people are a challenge. People are part of what creates pressure. To modify a phrase that I got from one of our global partners, people are often the Miracle-Gro for our sin pattern. Just being put into a relational context with people will challenge us. It's like pouring that Miracle-Gro on a plant and it just blooms. And sometimes our sin patterns do that when confronted with certain kinds of people. And so Peter wants to give us motivation today for how to handle both people and difficulties from God's perspective. So turn with me, if you haven't already, to 1 Peter chapter 1. We're going to do a little bit of review before we jump into the passage that we have before us this morning. In 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 3, we were told that God caused us to be born again to a living hope. We have this reality of a relationship with God that inspires a relentless hope in what he has done for us. Not what we are to do, but what God has done. He caused us to be born again to a living hope. That hope is the inspiration to continue living for him. And notice what that hope also has, verse 4, a great inheritance, a secure inheritance that God is protecting for us and protecting us for that inheritance, hope. But notice the order of the way he does this. He established the reality of our relationship with God, having caused us to be born again, before he's going to challenge us with what to do. He always puts right thinking before right acting, because God isn't just about behavior modification. He wants internal change. He wants to change from the inside out, and so he always starts with a reminder of who we are. Then look at chapter 1, verse 13. Therefore, we have a pivot point from this right thinking about who we are in Christ to right behavior. And Pastor Bo walked us through three commands in this section last week. Verse 13, set your hope fully on the grace of God. Hope in God. Because you have a relationship with him, you can hope in what he's done for you. In the process of that, he says, prepare your minds for action and be sober. So as you hope, it inspires our action. Verse 15, the second command, not only are we to be hopeful, we are to be holy. We are to be consistently set apart for God's use. Be hopeful, be holy. And then verse 17, a third command that Pastor Bo showed us last week, conduct yourselves in fear while on earth, awaiting the completion of your salvation. It's a strange command, don't you think? Fear. But when we understand who God is, when we relate to him appropriately, we don't want to do anything that disturbs what he has been doing in us. We want to understand that our belief in Christ, what God has done for us, is to be lived out. And so to conduct ourselves appropriately in response to who God is. We conduct ourselves in submission to God. We seek to live out who we are. And then the conclusion of that passage in verse 21, so that our faith and hope are in Christ. All of these different commands still rooted in the bigger purpose of our faith and hope being in Christ. That's what he said up to this point. Now he's going to transition us and continue that process by adding two more commands. All of these are general before he gets into the specifics next week. The two commands, chapter 1, verse 22, love one another earnestly from a pure heart, and chapter 2, verse 2, long for the spiritual milk of the word. Peter is going to challenge us to live out of this new perspective, the new reality of who we are, and he does it by weaving a tapestry of command, explanation, and motivation. Command, explanation, and motivation. He wants to make sure that we don't only know what we are to do, but why we are to do it. What we are to do and why. Before simply giving us information to act on, he always reminds us of who we are. Now, let me ask you a question. How many of you are rule followers? Now, when you see me raise my hand, those of you that are rule followers, you can raise your hand because that's the rule of the day. How many of you are rule followers? And what I mean by that is, if you have a job to do, you read the instructions first. I couldn't find a picture of a man. No, I wouldn't say that. Men do read instructions. This one just was better. So rule followers, they get the directions out before they try to put it all together. Or if you're a rule follower, when you go to the bank or when you go to the airport and there's a sign that says, wait here to be helped, you wait right there. Like this picture. This picture, there we go. Just waiting in line, no matter what the mob around you. But some of you, when you hear a rule, aren't rule followers. You think of a rule and you say, that must be a good suggestion. Sort of like speed limit signs. What? Somebody had fun with this speed limit sign and made it a suggested speed limit. Or when you are on vacation and you go to the pool and the pool says closed at 10, you assume that that's just a good suggestion and you go ahead and get in. Now, I wonder who in the world would do something like that. That's, by the way, from our vacation. So it's probably somebody that's related to me, or at least they have the same last name. But we won't pick on them too much. Some of you are rule followers. Some of you aren't. But I've yet to find somebody who is motivated by rules. I've yet to find someone who wakes up in the morning saying, "Oh, I can't wait to find a new rule to follow." We aren't motivated by rules. God knows that. Peter knows that. And so beyond giving us just commands, he gives us the reason behind the command and the motivation for why we should carry out these commands. That's going to be the challenge. Why are we to do it? Not just what are we to do? And so look with me at verse 22. Love one another earnestly from a pure heart. There's the command. Love one another earnestly. But before that, he gives us the reason. Beginning of the verse. Having purified your souls by your obedience to the truth, for sincere brotherly love, love one another earnestly from a pure heart. That first statement, having purified, that's not a command, it's a statement of reality. He's making a statement about what's true of us. He uses the perfect tense, which in Greek is something that's done in the past with present effect. So in the past, because you've trusted in Jesus as your personal Savior, you now are pure. Isn't that wonderful? Somebody should say amen at that point. Once we have trusted in Jesus, then how does he see us? As pure, having purified by obedience to the truth, having trusted in what he has done. Verse 18 says this, just look back a couple of verses. Knowing that you were ransomed from your futile way, inherited from your forefathers, not with perishable things such as silver and gold, but with the precious blood of Christ, like that of the Lamb without blemish or spot. Not a command, but the reality of who we are. When you have placed your faith in Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, he sees you as pure. That's part of the motivation for the challenge to love one another. You already have a settled state with God. Look further back at verse 8. Though you have seen him, though you have not seen him, you love him. Though you do not now see him, you believe in him and rejoice with joy that is inexpressible and filled with joy, obtaining the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your souls. That's the settled state that we have. He's saying, this is who you are. When you have placed your faith in Jesus Christ, you are settled in your relationship with him. Amen. Now we're prepared for the command. Now that we're reminded of who we are, now he can say, love one another earnestly from a pure heart. Love one another. So we have to define love. In our society, often love is just a feeling. But Peter's doing more than just challenging us to a warm, fuzzy feeling. Peter's not as concerned with how you feel towards each other. He wants you to act a certain way. He's not primarily concerned that you have a feeling towards each other, but you act in a certain way towards each other to live out the truth of God's word through other-centeredness with people. This love that he defines is an inner commitment to God first that is expressed in our conduct towards others. It follows after the model of Christ's love, where he gave himself for us, or the love of the Father who sent his Son for us. That's the beauty of what God does for us. Another way of defining love is doing what's best for somebody else, even if it costs me. Doing for somebody else what is best for them, not necessarily what they want, but what is best for them, even if it costs me. That's the challenge. That's a pretty big challenge. And he gives us two modifiers for it. Notice the modifier. Love earnestly. This word could be translated fervently or constantly. Peter's in essence say, love one another with all that you have, with all that you are. Keep doing it. Peter wants a church that is full of people who love one another and where intimacy with each other is the natural byproduct of having a relationship with God. That's his desire. That's what he wants. Earnest love. That's bold love. He wants us to boldly love each other. It might not be part of Lancaster County, but that's what he's saying. Bold love. Step out into that. Notice the second part. Love one another earnestly from a pure heart. No ulterior motive. Not loving in order to get something, but loving because it's the right thing for that person that needs my love. I think one of the greatest obstacles for us to do this kind of love is fear. When we have fear, it's very hard to have bold love. We fear rejection, so we don't really step out all the way. We feel fear being vulnerable or taking a risk. We fear loss of control when we do what's needed for somebody else. We fear true love because people are so used to platitudes. And Scripture calls us to speak the truth in love. So he challenges us to love boldly. That means we rejoice when someone else prospers, not looking to see if we're going to get the same thing. We rejoice when somebody's need is met, not worrying first about having our need met. It's putting away our list of grievances, covering the grievances with love. It's forgiving. That's when we are loving. When we're reaching out to those who can't do anything for us, we're loving. That's the challenge Paul gives us, to reach out. That's a pretty big command. Just look around for a minute. You don't even know everybody in the building. And he's saying, love each other boldly. That's a big challenge. That's a big command. So how can he do this? Why could he command this for us? Notice verse 23. Love one another earnestly from a pure heart, since or because you have been born again, not of perishable seed, but imperishable through the living and abiding word of God. Again, anchoring back to who we are. You can love because you have been born again. When we understand what God has done for us through the gift of salvation, it should release our ability to love. We've so been loved that we should love. It's a present reality. But notice that how he ties it to the Word of God. The reason we are born again is because of the truth that comes through the Word of God. There is no other way to know about the saving faith that we need in Jesus Christ without the Word. Without the Word of God, there's no access to the truth of God about salvation. And so he's emphasizing this. But notice the modifiers for this Word of God. It is living and abiding. Living, it's not stagnant, and it's abiding. It remains. It's consistent. It doesn't go out of style. The truths never wear out. The truths that God has established don't change. They continue on. They're part of what he has declared to be true. That's one of the reasons at Calvary we value living God's Word. Not only knowing what it means, but doing what it says. But in this context, the living out of God's Word requires another part of our value system, to grow with God's people, to have an authentic relationship with others for their good and for my growth, to put ourselves in a place where serving somebody else grows us and ministers to them. This is one of the reasons I'm so passionate about our learning environments, our ABFs, our small groups, our study and share and men's ministry, and many of our support teams that serve together, where these relationships are built and have an opportunity to have service coming from the relationship. Very interesting that God did not save us to make us individuals. He made us part of a family. As a matter of fact, the Christian life can't be authentically lived in isolation. We need others, and we need to be in those relationships. It's so important that he continues this subject into chapter 2. So look at chapter 2 with me. Jump down to verse 2 to see the next command. Like newborn infants, long for the pure spiritual milk, so that by it you may grow up into salvation. Long for the pure spiritual milk. This is a command to crave something. A command to have a desire for something. Not a duty. He's not saying, I want you to do this. He's saying, I want you to want this. How in the world do you crave a desire? How do you command a desire? He says, long for the pure spiritual milk. Long for the word of God. Let's talk about longing or desire for a minute. I'm not a super emotional person. So when I'm told to crave something or to long for something, I'm going to process it cognitively. I'm looking for the do's and the don'ts. I want the list. Help me understand the list, and that's not what Peter's giving us. Some of you are very driven by emotions. You long for that feeling of closeness with God. You long for that feeling of intimacy with God. Let me challenge both of us a little bit with the concept of desiring or craving or longing that he has here. Simple cognitive knowledge or decisions rarely produce life transformation and life-altering changes. Simple feelings normally do not lead to long-lasting, life-altering change. We need both of these. It's very interesting that God made us as a whole unit with intellect, will, and emotion. And all three of them are needed when we are looking at moving forward and being transformed. Not just a feeling and not just knowledge, not just action, but the internal response to transform us. But beyond our wiring, for some of us, the command to long the word of God may make us uncomfortable. Have you ever made that commitment that you're going to read your Bible? And you get through the week and the busyness of life, all the things that got in your way, and you go to pick up your Bible for church and you feel guilty? Or you've developed the habit of spending time with God. You're doing a reading plan through the Bible, but you admit that it's really just checking off some boxes. That you're going through the motions of reading, but it may be pretty dry. If we're all honest with each other, there are times like that for all of us, that we really don't crave the Word of God, that we don't crave time in the Word. There are even seasons where that happens. But Peter is not just instructing us to spend time in the Word. He has more in mind than just reading. He wants to merge devotion and duty together. There are times that the duty or the habit of spending time with God in His Word is what compels us or inspires the devotion. And other times, the devotion that keeps the duty going and the habit going. The duty is the thing that we can easily fall into, but he wants to put both of these two together. Duty and devotion must go together. But how can Peter command us to have that desire? How do we get there? He's going to give us a couple reasons in this passage for why he can command this. Notice in verse 2. Like newborn babes, long for the pure spiritual milk, that purpose, that by it you may grow up into salvation. We're already told in this book that you can know for sure that you can be saved, past tense. Peter's now saying you are growing in your salvation. In other places, we're told that you will be saved. Three different aspects of salvation. He's challenging us that now, with this ongoing aspect of our salvation, do you want to keep growing up into the salvation that he's given you? Long for the word. Do you want to live up to who he has declared you to be? Long for the word. This part of his motivation to move us that direction. But notice, I skipped verse 1. As we are trying to grow up in a relationship with God, what are some of the things that get in the way? Look at verse 1. Put away all malice and all deceit and hypocrisy and envy and all slander. People. Sometimes as we are trying to grow up into salvation, what gets in the way? People. But look at that list. That's an awfully harsh list, isn't it? Deceit, malice, hypocrisy, envy, slander. Surely none of us ever do that. It's amazing how easy those thoughts creep in. And it's interesting that this list that Peter gives is basically internal aspects of us. That many people will never know when you have envy. Many people will not really know that you're deceiving them, at least not at first. Many of us put on a mask, and so our hypocrisy is not evident. So these are not necessarily out very visible. These are internal things. And he's saying, if you want to grow up, these are the things that have to be removed. These are the things that will be changed as you encounter God and his word. That becomes the challenge. That's the context in which we will be growing. This challenge to grow up into our salvation is in light of living appropriately with others. But that's the beauty of the body of Christ. People are a test of our growth. They are not only a test of whether we're growing, they're a proof. You ever been in a relationship and you go, I responded right this time? That's the proof that God is doing something. But really, relationships are the catalyst for our growth. When we are close to people, when we are in relationship to people, the things that would cause us to have conflict are the ways that we see that God is still taking the rough edges off and working in us and trying to grow us up into this salvation. So when we are to long for, the command to long for the pure spiritual milk is to result in transformed relationships. So that's part of the motivation, that he's going to transform us because that's what he wants to do. But the real motivation is in verse 3. Long for the pure spiritual milk, that by it you may grow up into salvation, if indeed you have tasted that the Lord is good. Some translations translate this now or since, now that you have tasted or since you have, but it's a conditional statement. It's a conditional statement in the Greek that it assumes a positive answer. It assumes that it's true of them. So Peter, in essence, is thinking the best of his audience. He is assuming the best of them and is expecting them to be able to say, yes, that's true of me. But putting the if there requires the reader to say, is this true of me? It requires us to say, if indeed you have tasted that the Lord is good, is that true of me? Have I tasted that the Lord is good? If I've tasted that the Lord is good, the implication is that then I'm going to long for the pure spiritual milk. If you've tasted what is good, you want to continue to enjoy it. So how to illustrate this? I was going to read the ingredients to some cookies. But instead of that, and I couldn't ask my wife to make 3,000 of them, but I could ask her to make a few. So a few of you are going to be our taste testers this morning. These cookies are called Neiman Marcus cookies. They're my favorite. She made these yesterday, and I haven't had one yet. I figure I'm going to have to go for an extra long run this afternoon before I have one. But I need a few people to be taste testers. So if you could just take that and take a bite, and then I'm going to want to make sure. Here we go. Can you taste it? You have to taste it. You have to make sure you're taking a bite, because that's what the word taste means, right? You taste is to take a bite. So if you could, and did we get some teens over there? Good, because that they're going to be really hungry. Oop. You can share it with your husband if you want, but you don't have to. When you taste this, I've one thing I know about these cookies, what makes these cookies special is that they have oatmeal flour ground into them and about 8 or 10 ounces of Hershey's chocolate ground in beyond the chocolate chips. So these things are rich. And when they come out of the stove, I can't just eat one. When I take a bite of one, I want more. That's what Peter is trying to say to us. He's saying, taste and see. Taste that the Lord is good. When you've tasted that he's good, you want more. Now, because you have tasted that he is good, what do you want to do? Long for more of that. You want to have more of this encounter with God. When life is under pressure, which we all experience, when life is under pressure and we continually deal with the troubles of life, if we don't have that taste and see that the Lord is good, our perspective won't hold. And so he wants to remind us that to the Word of God is where the truth of God is found, but he wants more than just the duty of reading his Word. He wants us to long for the encounter with God. He doesn't simply want us to have a dry response to the Word of God. He wants to long for it. He wants you to not be able to wait for that next encounter, just like that cookie. I can't wait for that next cookie. That's how he wants us to long for him. And the only way that works is if we've truly tasted, if we've experienced the goodness of God. And we experience that through his Word. I was with a group of men this past week in a Bible study that went late into the evening. And as we closed, one of the men prayed something like, "Thank you for the sheer delight of opening God's Word together." That sheer delight, not the duty, but the sheer delight of seeing God in his Word. So let me encourage you to taste and see that God is good. Not to just go through the motions, not just to have your reading plan, but to make sure that you're encountering God. To read the Bible to encounter God, the Bible is not the goal. The Bible is the means to our encounter with God. That's the challenge. Let me give you two questions that I like to ask myself when I'm reading in any part of Scripture. What do I see of God in this passage, and how should I respond? As I read a passage, I want to keep asking, what is it about God that I should be seeing here? What truth, what characteristic, what reality about God am I seeing? And if that's true of him, how am I going to respond to it? It's tasting and seeing that God is good, tasting the wonder of who he is. Rather than just reading and forgetting, contemplating the reality of God. Have you ever had the experience that you do have your devotions in the morning and by 10 o'clock you can't remember what you read? Stop and ask that question. What do I see about God and how does he want me to respond? Make it more than just a duty, make it a devotion. If you need a place to start, let me give you 3 psalms that I was reading this week that you can practice this with. Psalm 139, Psalm 25, and Psalm 57. There are a lot of other places. Those were just 3 that I looked at this week. So don't let the busyness of life or the connectedness that we have in social media keep you from really contemplating who God is in his Word. Spend time with him. Enjoy him. And in light of who you see him to be, then you can love boldly in light of that. You can respond that way. So he tells us that we are going to grow up into our salvation as we respond to the Word. He tells us that we can taste the goodness of God. And then he gives us one last thing. Look at verses 4 through 10. This section is all about our identity together in Christ. This is another part of the motivation. A special relationship that we have together with Christ. I'm going to skip down to verses 9 and 10. Notice what he says about us. "But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people of his own possession. Did you notice those are all corporate things? None of those is individual. This is not just about us, it's about, or us individually, it's about us collectively. That you may proclaim the excellencies of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Once you were not a people, but now you are God's people. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. We are together this special people. That's why we are to love each other and why we are to respond appropriately to his word. So that together, notice the punchline, we may proclaim the excellencies of him who called us out of darkness into his marvelous light. When we love each other boldly, when we put aside division and seek the best of others, when we crave more intimacy with God and live out of that truth, what is the result? We proclaim the excellencies of Christ. We worship Christ. How do we best worship him? Together. How do we best declare the greatness of who he is? By demonstrating what he's done, transforming our lives and forming us collectively. It's his desire to be glorified by the diversity that he makes us to have. When we understand that our salvation is settled, that he doesn't simply want us to be better than those around us, when we understand what he has done for us in Christ and placing us into the body of Christ, then we proclaim the greatness, the virtue, the character of God. That ought to be an ultimate motivation for us, because that's what God most desires, is to be glorified. But we live in a selfie world, don't we? Where the focus is on self, not others. We live in a world where it's all about self-promotion, and God says, what you really need to do is promote me. To proclaim not who you are, but who he is. As we seek to fully taste that he is good and long for his word, as we seek to love one another boldly, may he truly be worshiped by us. May people look at us and say, there's no way that that group of people with their diversity should be unified. There's no way that that group of people who have so many differences should be unified and be able to worship God together. Only God does that. And therefore, may he be worshiped. Let's pray. Father, thank you that it is only through you that we have a relationship for eternity. It's only through what you did on the cross and sending Jesus to die in our place that we can even have the conversation about loving others the way you would want us to. Only because of what you have done for us can we truly taste and see that you are amazingly good. Would you inspire us to love each other because of what you have done? Would you compel us to want more of an intimate relationship with you that would transform our relationships, transform our behavior, transform our desires? Would you do it in a way that only you get glory? And may we as a church faithfully proclaim your excellencies. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's stand together as we sing a song in response.
Man of sorrows, Lamb of God, by his own betrayed, the sin of man and wrath of God has been. Thank you.
Thank you all for coming. If you are a guest, join us at the east entrance for our welcome gathering. And go with these words: but you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for his own possession, that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who called you. Let's proclaim well this week. Have a great week.